The chat window here, and we'll be getting started in just a second. We're now recording this session. Just so you know, and we may have some folks checking in. I'm seeing Greg raising his hand. Go ahead and text me in the chat window if you would. Can everybody hear okay? All good. Very good. Thanks, guys. Okay, well, I'd like to first introduce myself and our local chapter. We're the Los Angeles chapter of ACM SIGGRAPH, a professional chapter. And in case you didn't know, ACM is the Association for Computing Machinery. SIGGRAPH is the special interest group in computer graphics and interactive techniques within the ACM. This chapter has been around a long time. Folks have been running this since 1978. It was chartered in 91 formally. These are our elected officers. Also, who you're not seeing here are a few people who have been very helpful to us. I'm probably going to forget everyone's name, so I'll just keep going. activities, we actually being, you know, Los Angeles chapter, we have the pleasure and privilege of connecting with some of the top people in the film and television and visual effects industries. And we do 10 or more, sometimes events a year. We're a very busy chapter, and these are just a few of the events that we've done. I know that we're so a couple of folks who still need to get on here, panelists. I'll just chat a little bit more. Waiting for Brett, if he can jump on, that'd be awesome. And just going a little more, here's some contact info. If you'd like to reach out, we're currently looking for new members, but particularly officers, to run for our LA chapter office. And it's really been a lot of fun chairing this chapter. We have a great team. Everybody shows up for events. This is a bit of an experiment, as you might imagine, that we have, of course, we have the pandemic lockdown. And we thought, well, gee, we were going to cancel this event. This event was originally going to be held at the CTC, the Creative Technology Center, in near downtown LA at the brewery. And we ended up in. And what I'd like to do next is introduce our moderator, Mark Rickard. And you know, Mark is involved in running the CTC alongside Michael Page and team. And Mark is going to introduce the panelists. And Mark, do you wanna go live? And I think everyone's here now.
Hello, can you hear me?
Oh yeah, hi Brett.
I've been here the whole time, actually.
Oh, excellent.
Someone okay. Else is controlling the access, so it's like a Big Brother is...
is that yes. Well, you know how that is.
That's me. That's me. This is my panel. Let's get one thing straight. Okay, so, that was easy. Wow.
So I like,
this,
away,
I like this virtual dynamic. It works really well. I appreciate that, Ed. I presume that you're going to be screen sharing the slideshow as we go through here. So perhaps we will ingest you back into the panel at points for your expertise, but for the time being, let's take it away.
Toodaloo.
All right, thanks so much. Hi, everyone. I would like to welcome you all to our virtual meetup. I hope this finds each of you safe and comfortable wherever you may be tuning in from. I'm coming to you from the virtual command center, if you will, of the Creative Technology Center in Los Angeles, where we otherwise would have been tonight. Also, some of you will be watching this while immersed in a WebXR virtual environment, which is created specifically for this event by our friends at XR Chat. So shout out to Liam Shaw, Dimitri, Thomas, all doing amazing work. The WebXR is a significant advent because it allows anyone to convene in virtual space from any browser on any device without the need to download an app, which is something I know many of us are looking for right now, and certainly a corollary element to the theme of our panel this evening, which is next-gen storytelling in a virtually connected world. Okay, so we'll have this this Zoom window activated with a look at what's going on inside in that WebXR room, primarily because, you know, well, no one's ever done it before, so we always enjoy that, and you can't be too meta. The meta, the better. For those of you who haven't gone into the WebXR realm, we'll have it open all night, and we'll put the link right there in the chat window here on the Zoom feed. Some acknowledgments before we get started. First of all, off the top, the Los Angeles chapter of ACM SIGGRAPH, thank you very much for hosting this, and also thank you to the people who came in who aren't members by way of donations, because SIGGRAPH is a nonprofit organization, and those donations are very helpful in this uncertain and expansive time for what we all do here, the immersive arts. But if you'd like to learn more about the LA chapter of SIGGRAPH or become a member, you can go to lasiggraph.org. Appreciate it once again, Ed, the president of the chapter, Ed Lance, and also tonight's guest, VJ. Thank you to the VP, Edward Arroyo, who conceived the programming here, and the entire board, Leonard, Dave, Joan, and Fran, for the work that went into getting this going. Would like to thank Threeopolis Media, Don Schneider and Dan Weinberg, who are the owners of the Creative Technology Center. The CTC XR Network is with whom this panel is in conjunction. And of course, the inimitable Michael Page, who actually runs the place. So I think that pretty much covers the shout outs. A special mention for my wife, Melissa, who, for her noble effort in cutting my hair and helping me not look a fright, or at least feel like I don't look a fright. Okay, so let's get started with our panel here tonight. We have some very special guests from the world of immersive storytelling. I'll introduce them, and then we'll go into a discussion about the immersive landscape, et cetera, and we'll spend some time viewing and dissecting a specific piece of content they each created. So it should be very rewarding. First off, my name is Mark Rickard. I'm thrilled to be serving as your moderator this evening. I am a film and immersive producer. I'm a production executive at CTC. I'm the head of immersive for Studio Lightship. And in 2017, I founded the high-level immersive content creation company, Virtuality. So obviously, I'm heavily invested in the space, and I swear I'm not just in it for the money. Okay, so I'm going to start pulling this panel together here. So first off, he is an XR creator, a member of the Oculus VR Launchpad program, and director of the game-changing VR film Agent Emerson. Please, if you will, let's welcome Ilya Rozhkov. There he is. Wonderful. Hi, Ilya.
Nice to
Good
see
to see you. Can you hear us okay?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, wonderful. Moving right along here. She is a pioneering immersive filmmaker whose wide list of accomplishments include MIT honoree and South by Southwest keynote speaker. She's currently the director of the ICT Mixed Reality Lab at USC and founder of Bray Pictures. Please welcome Jessica Brillhart. Hi, Jessica. I'm going to unmute you. It's a very rigid technique to get into this room, but once you're in, you know, you're in for life.
Oh, good. It's not crazy at all. You know?
Well, you're in for at least the next 2 hours.
Oh, sure. Okay. Yeah.
So we're golden there.
All right.
All right. So then the only other person remaining on this panel, he may need no introduction. And at this point, we've had him in the bullpen getting ready to get in here. But he is widely regarded as the godfather of VR, having introduced the concept of VR to popular culture in his hit 90s film, The Lawnmower Man, which most people have seen. That film, plus his other major releases, Virtuosity and the IMAX 3D spectacle T-Rex, were each credited with cinematic innovations that were eventually adopted by all of Hollywood, quite frankly. He's a thought leader, he's a futurist, he's a visionary director and founder of Studio Lightship. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you at last Brett Leonard. I hope. There he is.
I've been here the whole time. It keeps knocking me out without me touching anything. So,
well, Brett, we are all working through the challenges of the virtual world.
Yeah,
so,
I know.
So just like anything else, you know, we gotta take our lumps.
For God's sake.
I know, right? Okay, well, this is it, though. This is the panel. This is the money crowd. As you can see, I've got the WebXR bot showing us what's going on here in WebXR, and we'll be diving into a lot of that later regarding, you know, the use cases and theory and whatnot. For the time being, let's kick this panel off, right? So we'll do it in traditional fashion. We'll go around the room, ask some questions, and off the top, I'm gonna say let's take a 1,000-foot approach. A question for everyone. So we all on this panel come from the traditional film world. Our backgrounds are in traditional film and cinema. So what would you guys say are the early returns on how this new medium evolves or expands traditional storytelling? Brett, since you know we kept you in the paddock longest, we'll start with you.
Okay. Well, look, this is, for me, it's an extension of just what's been my religion my whole life, which is cinema. This is an extension of that language, with immersion, of course, being a very unique extension. But if you actually look at the history of cinema, there's been all kinds of experiments in the context of environmental storytelling and all kinds of things. And so I'm looking at it as an extension of those things, but of course, a very unique one that also engages people in terms of agency and, you know, game logic, for lack of a better term. And so, you know, this is one of the amazing things for me is that everyone on this panel is doing such radically different things with the medium right now. And that's, I think, an amazing, you know, sort of example, the fact that we're in this beginning phase of really exploring what the medium affords. And it's like being at the back at the beginning of cinema to begin with. So one of the things I'm trying to do is a hybrid approach of connecting, you know, traditional storytelling in with immersive storytelling and seeing if those things can be friendly to each other. And anyway, that's sort of the opening salvo for me. Mark, are you talking? I can see your lips moving, but I'm not hearing you. Is that?
Oh no, it's just my virtual producer in my ear.
gotcha.
Giving me some messages from the booth.
This just wants to be a quick intro of what we're going to talk about, right? So.
Correct. And over to the other panelists. Yeah, what would you say? What would you say the current ecosystem looks like for how this new medium expands your traditional storytelling techniques?
I think the evolution has been very evident, and it's beautiful to be a part of, because when VR of this generation came to be, it was like a sponge, taking an experience of theater, experience of cinema, experience of games. But now more and more pieces emerge which are unique and exclusive to virtual reality, which I think a sign of beginning of maturing of this medium. We're still in very, very early phases, like Brett said, but we start to see the unique identity of virtual reality. And that's great, that's beautiful. And it's great that all the panelists here have such a radically different approach to this medium. But my personal mission with virtual reality is infusing cinematic storytelling into that medium in a way authentic to virtual reality.
Nice. Well, having seen some of your pieces, I know that's truly the case, and we'll get a little bit more into that. Jessica, what about you? How has this expanded your creative brain with regard to storytelling?
How has it blown my mind? Well, let me count the ways. No, I think for me, my approach is more about diving into why we do what we do in cinema in order to better understand, you know, like we never edited because editing was fun or cool. I mean, like same with cinematography, same with acting, like all of those technicalities of the craft came from a need to embrace a very true way that we perceive the world in order to best leverage the technology and the medium at hand. So I think for me, it's been a lot of finding those tension points where doing the traditional cinematic thing isn't working. Not in the traditional way, not in the filmmaker-y type way. And we've learned, you know, that filmmaking isn't, you know, it's not a one-to-one by any stretch. So a lot of it is just really getting to the heart and the truth of why we do certain things we do, like we, the way that we do in cinema, and finding what the right translation is of doing that in something like VR, AR, in the immersive space, where to what Brett said earlier, you know, we have agency, we have presence, we have convincing manipulation in certain ways, of being in a place or having an experience that you've, you know, never had, or being in a place you've never been, and so on. So I think there's a new set of perceptual capabilities that we're introducing here, which means we have to really rethink what this language is. And so a lot of my work is really thinking about the theory behind that language, thinking about how that language is evolving, thinking about ways that content evolves. And I think storytelling is also a bit of a throw, because, you know, now that we have people in these experiences, and I feel that many people who are listening in on this have probably heard this time and time again, is that storytelling as it's been known no longer applies in this medium. It is a magnitude away from that. It's thinking about compelling people to perhaps experience the story that you had in mind, but you have to have them want to experience that, as opposed to directing them to experience that. So I think that's where the crux is for me, and where the interesting stuff is for me.
Yeah, and there's been you know, a theoretical evolution on that front at a very brisk clip as well. So it's interesting to see how, you know, as every month, every quarter, every year goes by, we're now finding a theoretical shift in the things that they just 6 months ago, 8 months ago said would never be possible, didn't make sense in XR storytelling. It really is a pioneering frontier that we're all plowing forward on.
Oh yeah, I mean, like when I first started, they were saying that you couldn't edit in VR, and you can't in the traditional sense. But it was about rethinking how to do that. It's one of those things where you're there. Yeah, I think someone said there is no, there's trying, or I think Phil said that just now.
I totally agree. I think there's, you know, there are no, anyone that thinks that there are rules or a rhetoric established now is crazy. It is truly a time of experimentation. I think I'm mostly interested in creating a bed for that experimentation as much as possible, and allowing people to think out of the box. And also, you know, look at the fact that, you know, I agree with what Jessica was saying, that the word storytelling is not really apropos here, but it's more like story worlding, you know, and creating these worlds. But weirdly enough, if you go back in history to the beginning of how people, you know, how humans shared quote unquote story or narrative, it was much more interactive. It was much more environmental. It was based in ritual, tribal ritual, things that, and I think that there's some ancient antecedents to this moment we're in right now that are very, very interesting to look at from the standpoint of structure and how to create an environment of a story world. And that's one of the interesting things for me. And then trying to kind of see where the tenets of cinematic language, which, you know, are still, it's still very young. Cinema itself as an art form is still very young. Where that fits, where it doesn't. I'm a bit more of a messy mixer. I believe that there are ways of mixing these things together and just trying things that might be interesting. But as Phil Lilienfeld just said in the chat, hi Phil, I saw you, he said, there is no try, there is only doing. And I think that's true. We have to jump in with the tools and actually, you know, play with them, which is why I've been calling for this idea of an immersive new wave, you know, to play with breaking the rules before there are any rules that are actually codified.
And I strongly agree. And when it comes to storytelling, VR is very different. However, the story itself, that hasn't changed. That's the way we perceive information. But in virtual reality, if put into perspective, for the first time in the history of our species, we can convey information the way we naturally perceive it. All around us, with us choosing where to look, in three dimensions. And that's unprecedented situation. And of course, we draw experience from cinema, we draw experience from games when it comes to interactivity, but the editing of VR and the usage of soundtracks of VR and all the things which cinema went through, that is still to be discovered. And trial and error is the best way. Of course, thought through trial and error. And like somebody put in chat, you do or do not. So yeah, I hell agree with that.
Yes, that was a nugget from Phil Lilienfeld, who's one of Jessica's cohorts and a Yoda to us all in so many ways in this space. Okay, so that's interesting. You know, the broad stroke insight. I'm curious with regard to our panelists. I mean, the attendees that we have on here right now. There's a little feature that allows you to raise your hand on this thing. By show of hands, I'm curious how many of these people that are in this room right now have VR headsets. They actually are headset owners. They consume media via headsets. You know, it's not the same as looking at a room of hands going up, but there looks like there's a good portion of hands in the air. And I would honestly expect nothing less from this crowd, because these are the people who presumably understand the landscape and perhaps appreciate storytelling in XR as you know, as much as anyone. But by those metrics, you know, everybody in here is seeing the content. So for the people that don't engage in VR, is there a world in the near term or ever where the word immersive is or immersive story rather is not tethered to having to see it in a VR headset?
That's interesting. I think
it's already like that, isn't it? I mean, we have phones can do AR very well. We have immersive audio that's through headphones, and you know, audio itself has always been very immersive with or without kind of a spatial awareness for it, you know. Books are very immersive.
When it comes to audio, I recently found the book which is the first manual on how to record sound on set, and one of the first things it says that unlike cameras, audio reproduce the experience in a way authentic to how it has been. So it's way more immersive in that sense since the very beginning of it.
Yeah, I agree that even in cinema, the most immersive aspect has been the audio landscape sound design once sound actually came into the medium that made you have, you know, the feeling of presence more than anything, and the feeling of emotional presence. You know, the artifice of visual language, and as Jessica said, we don't edit just for the fun of it. The editing was trying to create something that was approximating reality, and yet it was such a, you know, stylized form of that. The fact that editing even works is interesting, and thinking about that is actually how you have to think about it in the context of VR, XR editing and storytelling. It often, you know, it needs to be so organic to the experience and how the mise-en-scene is enveloping everyone. And that's going back to first principles in ways in terms of what is an edit and what is it meant to be expressing. You know, so, you know, of course there's been tremendous amount of immersion in theater from the very beginning. A lot of experimentation, a lot of the experimentation in avant-garde theater that happened, in the 20th century, especially was in early 20th century, is very apropos to what we're doing now in the context of things. But I'd love to have Jessica talk more about the AR stuff, because I know you've been working with AR and audio storytelling as an immersive thing, and I think it's a great
now, Mr. idea. Leonard. Once again, I have to put my gavel down. This is a moderated panel. It's not a free for all. I have plenty of questions for Jessica.
I'll talk about it, but it's on the list of things to talk about, Brett. We're good. I'll talk.
Yeah.
About it.
Okay.
especially because I mean, Brett, I touched upon something you said there, whereby you've said it a couple of times already. How basically. And you and I have had this conversation. We share the same philosophy that all storytelling is really connected to original storytelling, and all forms of innovation in cinema or any medium, once they find their footing, are an evolution of the original tenets. In their best presentation, they're an evolution of the original tenets of storytelling from, you know, the days of Homer and perhaps before. I think universally, as a panel, we all share that, despite the fact that we have, you know, a diverse POV, we all very very much share that collectively as a group. And for anybody out there who's you know, looking for the trailblazers, they're all right here in this panel at the moment. So keep listening. But speaking of the POV, brings to mind Ilya's piece. I want to talk a little bit about the piece that you created, which to my mind is so far the best use of first person POV I've seen in VR. I mean, seriously, it's the way so many VR scripts I see wish they could tell their stories. It's a masterful, you know, if I dare use that term. You and I have talked a lot about the ongoing evolution of the cinematic landscape, and I believe you also subscribe to the mantra, innovate or die, right? So can you share your, encapsulated philosophy on this time we're living through and how it will impact the identity of traditional cinema?
Absolutely. Innovate or die, you brought up. I think that's a hugely important aspect throughout all the history of storytelling and art. If we look at entertainment landscape, there are three pillars it stands on, and it used to stand on, and it will stand on. It's technology, it's business side of it, and it's art of it. And they need to work together for something beautiful to come to fruition. They balance each other, and all of them need to innovate or die. If you look, for example, at television, it innovated to become VOD and Netflix. That's a great example of evolution in the business part of it. If you look at technology, the whole cinema started as technology, and it kept evolving and pushing storytelling, with storytelling pushing it further. And art, there are so many examples of art being pushed, but French New Wave would be one great of the examples. So that is a certain chaos, but it's always in movement. And in the end of the day, the audience are real winners, because all of those forces, they push each other. Sometimes the experiments don't work, sometimes they do, but taking audience experience in the context of philosophy and culture of that time, contemporary to the time when art piece was created, putting that into perspective is the key to evolution and learning from the past as well. So when we were working on Agent Emerson, that was the key component. We were trying to define what aspects of cinema could be infused authentically to virtual reality, and sometimes innovate our way. And we designed a camera to put on actor's head for him to go through all the stunts and adventures to share that with the audience. And that was at the time where people were saying you can't move camera in VR, that makes people sick. So an extensive research had to be made to design a camera which would mitigate motion sickness and make it a comfortable yet thrilling experience to the audience. So innovation has to come to from technology point of view, from storytelling point of view, and from business point of view. That's probably would be my application of innovative die mantra.
Yeah, so you actually designed a camera rig to execute the first person POV. Is that something that has an afterlife, or was it a one-off?
There has been a lot of things invented for the film specifically. How the film started is I got hands on my first virtual reality headsets, which was an Oculus dev kit. And I spent the whole day in it thinking what type of story would be possible inside the headset, but would make no sense outside. And that's how Agent Emerson came to be. And then I thought, how do we execute it? And there was literally no technology available to do so. Either the picture quality was bad or the motion sickness was a problem, and none of it could literally shoot 3D. So I sat down with engineers and we created identity capture camera, which allows the POV filming in high quality 3D and with a high comfort for the audience as well. And many aspects like it, we had in engine interactions designed for it, different algorithms and models designed for it specifically. And it does have an afterlife. And actually the next iteration of the camera is being designed right now.
Interesting. That's exciting. You know, I know we're not going to get a chance to actually like see your piece, and I encourage people to go check it out, but we are going to have an opportunity to show a trailer here to people so they know what we're talking about. And then, afterwards we can talk a little bit about your experience. So I will kick it over to VJ Ed Lance for showing us. For people who have the Zoom window activated, you'll see the trailer here for Agent Emerson.
Good morning, Agent. Please state your name for the record.
David Emerson, CIA.
Good. Now beginning phase one.
Kill him.
Alex, run!
Agent Emerson has broken free of the simulation.
David, listen to me. He's just in your head. Sure, you're still you.
It's all about to be over.
Right on.
Cool.
So I'm sure you know everybody's applauding in their self-isolation vigorously, but you know, as someone who's gone through the experience, if I can say it that way, it was riveting. You know how you were able to, as you've already pointed out, show things from a first person perspective, make you feel like you are the protagonist, move the camera in ways that previously were verboten. And of course, you know, you saw in there a brief clip of skydiving. I mean, the whole thing takes you on a real journey. It does make you feel like it's a spy thriller. So I encourage anybody who has a headset, find Agent Emerson. I think you'd go to agentemerson.com, check it out, download it. It's well worth it. It's a seminal advent or seminal contribution, I should say, to this medium. And I know it's been a great calling card for you, Ilya, and I believe as a result, you're doing a touring program with Verizon as part of their filmmaker support for the 5G rollout. And that brings to my mind, basically with regard to what you know now from your experiences, how much do you think the forthcoming advent of 5G is going to play a factor in XR's storytelling future?
5G is for sure a game changer. It is the future. It's a matter of time until it rolls out, and that's the big question: how long will it take for it to come? But it's massively enables completely different workflows, and it enables cloud-based rendering, which pretty much allows for high-end experiences on very affordable headsets. It's huge for augmented reality. It not only gives completely different toolkit when it comes to production, it also gives a completely different way to take content in. We're at very early stages of 5G right now, and the toolkit is being designed. It's not yet there. Ways of consuming content using 5G, they're not yet there in their full either. It's a beginning of a new age, and how 4G introduced things like Uber and gig economy and affected how we perceive things and how we interact with the digital world. 5G is going to be a huge leap forward in that department, because we could interact with 3D models in real time on the most affordable devices.
Yeah, so I would agree. Although I'm trying, I really want to see the adoption and the application beyond the hype cycle and beyond, you know, the promise of what's going on out there. I mean, Jessica, you're basically immersed, for want of a better term, in a lot of the technical side of things at ICT. What's your take on if 5G is a salvation or game changer?
Well, I mean, a good example from my experience, well, for one, there's no 5G yet, so it's really hard to know exactly what's going to happen. So
now.
Yeah.
Don't let all the commercials conspiracy theorists hear you say that, because it's
started COVID, right?
Yeah,
that's what I'm hearing. You know, that's a
don't make me mute you.
Yeah, sorry. Glad that you invited me, right? So, you know, I think the infrastructure use cases here are really important and imperative, especially if you're looking at XR on the web, if you're looking at, actually anything cloud-based, because, you know, doing rendering live in the cloud is going to be big. Being able to pull higher fidelity assets and render them in real time. I think being able to leverage real time in all sorts of new ways, leveraging data streams in all sorts of new ways. I think, you know, web is the future, sure, but that's also, you know, data-driven real-time experiences are where we're trying to get at.
Yeah.
You make a decision, it responds in real time. You don't need the internet in order to do it. You don't need to be offline in order to do it. That means better social experiences. That means collaboration across a network. That means, you know, future of work stuff, et cetera, which right now is obviously something that we could use. I mean, we're doing it on Zoom-ish, so. I think a pretty important story that I heard recently, you know, we have a project that we're trying to get off the ground that involves education and involves sort of rethinking what a textbook is and like, how do we evolve that conversation? And I went to a school in Southgate, it's the STEAM Legacy School there. And a surprising thing, which I guess isn't that surprising, but it was to me at the time, was that their internet connection is so awful, but their cell phone connection is great. And so if they had 5G at the school, at an educational level, they'd actually be able to pull in like all sorts of information. They'd be able to, now there's security issues there, and so they'd have to rethink that whole thing. But the basically they're saying that their cell phone service, and all the kids have cell phones. They don't necessarily have the internet, but they do have cell phones. So that kind of like, really thinking about the have and have nots, thinking about leveling the playing field. I think not to say that everyone can afford 5G, but I think there are initiatives around Verizon that's starting to roll this out in neighborhoods that wouldn't necessarily get it first. So they're really, they are starting to think more broadly about what are the use cases here? How does this, like, you know, help us to redefine education, to reimagine what it's like, you know, being a student that doesn't necessarily, can't, their family can't afford the internet, but they can afford a cell phone and they want a cell phone. And like, how does that give them the power to be able to connect with the world and each other in really good ways? So, yeah, so I think about it from that perspective, I think, from an infrastructure perspective and how that, you know, every infrastructure evolution changes the game for everything, like all boats rise. So I think that that's actually gonna be really important for how this whole thing evolves.
And when it comes to application, one interesting applications which happened already during the Oscars, Verizon did that. They live streamed Academy Awards in virtual reality, 8K 3D from LA to New York with practically no delay. And that's a very interesting application to sharing locations live in virtual reality. To
bring, I mean, really the 5G and what it is, it's designed, what other thing is going to absorb that capacity except two-way virtual experience? And I mean, its whole raison d'etre is to allow and the enablements of what everyone was just talking about. It's sort of organic and endemic to it. You know, it's not, it's what else are people going to do with download 1,000 more videos every hour? I mean, it's a capacity that needs to be absorbed by greater human interaction. And I think that's a positive thing, especially if we tell the meta narrative and contextual story around that correctly, which is a, you know, a whole other thing to unpack.
Yeah, it is. And actually 5G is its own thing to unpack as well. I mean, I didn't intend for this panel to veer off in the direction of either pro or con 5G. I have no opinion other than to say that I have seen it used meaningfully. I have seen a lot of immersive creators and technicians benefit from its implementation. And I look forward to the ubiquity of it in so much as it improves our workflows with, you know, low latency and high bandwidth. And getting our hands on it. Darn it. Okay, well, so.
We know edge computing is also a big thing. Yeah. Just throwing that out there too.
5G and edge computing together are really, that's the cake.
That yeah. Makes, yeah. Exactly.
And that's, if people don't know what edge computing, it's such a different thing than thinking of the way the cloud works. And, you know, it's, and then you go all the way to mesh net thinking. And, you know, there's a lot of, innovations that are really just at the cusp right now. And that's going to make this explosion. Of course, it couldn't be at a better time. This inflection point in history we're at, you know, I mean, if we are able to have deeper, more intimate and real connections with human beings in virtual space and virtual experience because of this technical enablement, then this thing means something. If it's not that, then it does something very different. And that's sort of the larger story in terms of next gen storytelling right now. Really, that storytelling needs to address this moment we're in, not from the standpoint of the crisis itself, but the standpoint of humans pivoting into a greater virtual experience. And what does that mean to things like intimacy and communication? You know, just navigating the ritual of a Zoom panel is kind of like awkward for us all right now. It's like we are in incredible training wheel, you know, moment here, because the ritual and onboarding for actual full immersive virtual experience, very few people have even touched that as an overall consideration. And those of us who are early adopters, of course, we jump in full, you know, full body. But it's just that's something I think really needs to be addressed and is connected to this idea of next-gen storytelling writ large.
100%.
One of the interesting demos which were shown at Oculus Connect last year was actually sharing virtual spaces in a very intimate way, with them being live scanned and with people being live scanned. So we could be sitting virtually in the same room and seeing each other mimic in real time. And 5G is going to be great for that also.
Yeah, well, and as you mentioned, you know, edge computing, definitely the way forward. We've come a long way in a very short period, to say the least. Speaking of which, Jessica, you were probably one of the earliest immersive adopters of all, having helped found and expand the Google Jump platform in its very first days. What insight can you afford from that experience, and particularly how far we've come?
I mean, what do you want to know? What specifically? There's all sorts of things you can learn from that.
Well, as someone who was working in traditional storytelling prior to VR cameras ever existing, certainly just big rigs like that.
Mm-hmm.
Was the learning curve? I mean, I would presume it's significant, but how did you even approach it in terms of being handed this thing that said now ideate in 360 space?
I think it was a lot of being wrong most of the time. It was a lot of being okay with being wrong. I know that maybe sounds like a stump speech, like, you know, fail hard. And I did. No, I think it's a lot of trial and error. I think the benefit that I had, I think we talked about this before too. It's not for a lack of wanting to do VR, but I certainly didn't pursue it. It wasn't like I put on a headset and said, I'm going to do this now. I was just like, all right, cool. I got sick in that villa in Italy or whatever. And I thought it, sorry, my dogs are nuts. So I remember feeling, with this particular equipment that I had the benefit of being able to film and stitch a fair amount pretty quickly and be able to be in a headset and actually see what the end results would be. And I think what it was really just about, you know, filming a lot, watching a lot, and really allowing myself to experience it and being very honest with myself about what I thought. Like, I think one of the big takeaways from my initial film was, or film experience, I should say, was World Tour, which is the first thing I made with Google Jump, back when we were just testing it out. It was 3D printed rig with 16 GoPros in an array. I'm sure you've all seen some version of that. We broke one of the rigs on Arecibo, which is another story for another time. But I thought that we went to Tokyo because I was like trying to find like ways of capturing the world's experience to see, like, you know, if I throw it at a hot thing, what happens? If I throw it at a cold thing, what happens? Like, what does that feel like? And I actually used a Kurt Vonnegut quote, and I hello babies, welcome to Earth. It's hot in the summer and cold in the winter. It's round, it's wet, it's crowded. So it was like these different concepts of the human experience and trying to find examples within the world that I could film. That's what I thought I was doing, filming things. So I went to Tokyo assuming crowded would be cool. Like, Tokyo is like so techie and awesome. And like, I filmed it and it was awful. But then I went to Iceland where I'm like, oh, it's gonna be boring, a bunch of rocks. And it was great. So you had these like two very different, like in film, you'd be like, okay, I would film like Iceland rocks for a little bit and people would just get bored and maybe, unless it was like Herzog and it was awesome. But then you would do like Tokyo and it's like everything's alive and bright and vibrant. But what you realize is Tokyo is built to be very front of mind. Like, you see it and you see the robot and the robot's cool, but then you look behind you, there's a bunch of ads. So it's like good over here, but terrible over here. So you're already eliminating like the majority of the space. You're sort of like, why VR kind of comes up. And I think that's the major question. Why is this in VR? What's the point of that? Is that important? Is that not important? Is this better as a film? Is it not? So I think a lot of those kind of questions were bubbling up as it related to the technology. I started having, I felt like my brain was just being completely rewired. Forget being in a headset and thinking that maybe that's rewiring our brains, another topic. But like this idea that what I was doing was actually really forcing me to think differently about what was going on here. And yeah, so it was very important to work with the technology and to think about what a behemoth of a thing this is and how it's not going to just be a matter of release the camera and get filmmakers to use it and we'll figure out VR. It was never going to be that. It's still not.
Well, it's still not, you know, I mean, it's still not. And I think we all have to go through the same machinations when starting a piece. As we've seen, the early days of VR were purportedly, you know, 360 was the way. And now at least half of the storytelling community, if not more, based on the support initiatives from the platforms, is embracing 180, because like you said, it's look this way there, that's what you're looking at, and back there, what is it? I know, Brett, you have philosophically a kind of a take on that with regard to 360 versus 180, and asking yourself why something's in VR to begin with.
Yeah, I mean, I think right now all of it is valid. I mean, I no one has experimented with this enough to say that any one thing works better than the other. I think that there are stories, there are environments, there are experiences that match. The 180 is a great way of telling things. And then, you know, like in the Hollywood Rooftop piece that we did, we pivot between 180 and 360 depending on what the scene was organically, how many people, what was the actual dynamic of the ensemble, because it was an ensemble driven thing. So we were, you know, utilizing the medium coming out of what was being demanded by the story and the character interaction. So I don't think that there's any one way of doing it that's correct right now.
Is it safe to say, however, to all you guys, is it safe to say that there is a sort of a partition of something should be immersive, something shouldn't be immersive, like firm dividing line?
I think Brett has already given an answer in his previous response, demanded by the story. That's the key. Yeah. If it's 180 because it is demanded by the story, then great. If it's 180 because the creators couldn't figure out how to work with 360, not that great. If there is a technological limitation, it needs to be bypassed with technology or designed, or the experience needs to be designed within the creative limitations. It needs to be authentic to 180 or 360, whatever the story demands.
Yeah. So the takeaway is that there's no catch-all for any immersive content. So that
interesting enough, I mean, I'm one of the interesting things about this panel is that I'm seeing a Q&A pull down menu here, and people are asking questions. they're you know, one person, Ivan, it's talked about, you know, the biggest hurdle is the headsets themselves. I mean, so no one knows where exactly this is going to land in terms of what is the delivery for virtual experience actually going to be. That and that's an elephant in the room that we all have to deal with. I think building the muscles of telling, telling, it's hard not to use that word, but of creating experiences within an immersive way will be able to be utilized in whatever the delivery system is going to be. That's why the experimentation with what we have now, whether it be headsets or AR or any of the myriad ways you can deliver immersion, is really critical, because eventually the things that will win in terms of delivery will happen, but we're still a ways away from knowing where that's going to land. And that's one of the biggest questions that people always ask. It's like, well, I don't like, you know, VR headsets aren't cool. VR is cool, but VR headsets are not. That's one of the things in the questions.
So love wearing big boxy plastic half of my face. I don't know what you're talking about, Brett. Super fun.
Yeah.
Great.
I can't believe it's going to be boxes on our heads.
That's it. That's VR. I don't know, man. Like, that's it.
there's plenty of people working overtime to change that, I assure you.
Yeah.
Still pumping lots of money into
it. It's the point, right? The technology isn't the goal here. It's like, it's a great way for us to better understand what this, I mean, it's like I think there's a couple of things here, right? Like, the technology is the tool that we use to better understand what this thing is. And I think the technology will always change. I definitely at Google saw plenty of things go by the wayside, VR especially, you know, seeing, you know, the rig that I used in 2015 no longer exists, you know, Daydream no longer exists, Cardboard no longer really exists, you know, like.
But that's not an indictment on Google, right?
No, it's not. I mean, it's just they have a particular, you know, technology companies have goals. They have OKRs. They have things they need to do. They need to push the stuff out. They need to justify it. So we can't rely on technology. We just can't. I mean, it's just the nature of tech, you know, things change very rapidly. But the medium as the truths of it, I think, remain intact. And I think each of these new technologies give us completely different insights on like what this medium actually means to people. And ultimately what we're trying to get as the content, which is a bad, I think content as a word is a bad word because it
I agree. I hate like, content.
Yeah. So I say that with love. It's more like it could be stories. It could be what these experiences are, but it's figuring out what is it that the medium wants to do? How do we get people to get excited about that? How do we, or not even that, it's more how do we create value here? How do we connect people in different ways? What is it that we're as creators trying to express here? And how is that going to evolve into something bigger than what it is right now?
I feel it's an innovative-die balancing act, because on one hand, you have the technology making the headsets less like boxes on our heads. On another hand, we have making those headsets affordable and fun for everyone. And there is already progress in that, because buying the first iteration of Oculus for $1,000 and the Windows PC for another $1,500 is not as much fun as just going and buying an Oculus Go for $150 on Black Friday. That's already progress there. And when it comes to content, again, there needs to be experimentations, having different types of content in mind, figuring out the storytelling formula. So innovation in three areas at the same time. And then something mainstream will come to be. That's the only way.
I agree.
And I think that Half-Life's done a really great job. I don't know if mm-hmm. either of you have experienced it, but I think mm-hmm. there's something they've done, Valve has done some really amazing work in terms of figuring out, you know, or experimenting with different modes of like, you know, how do we move through space? Mm-hmm. How much violence is too much violence? Like the agency is beyond just, you know, easy, medium, hard, you know, it's more like how comfortable are you? Are you sitting down? Are you standing up? Do you want to do both? Do you want to like, there's a little bit, there's like this kind of, cause right now it's also like one size for technology, like, needs to kind of fit all. And we're already asking a lot of our audiences in terms of, again, putting these bulky things on their faces and doing anything. And then we're saying like, do it right. And they're like, what do you mean do it right? Like, what does that mean? So I think there are some really interesting, like I feel, and you know, again, ups to Valve for being able, I mean, a great gaming company creating a really great game in VR is not a shocker, but you know, I think there's a lot we can learn from some titles that are coming out from them and others right now too.
I would agree. I think that as we're sitting here talking, there's people who are ideating the thing that's going to be, you know, send shockwaves and impress all of us that are in the immersive community. And more and more you're seeing evidence of that. And towards the end of the panel, we'll discuss some of the latter day advents that are exciting to you guys. But that's talking about VR. I find it particularly interesting, Jessica, that you're one of the first people to employ AR as a tool to engage audiences in a very story-driven way. We have a video of a piece that you did that, if I'm not mistaken, it was playing at Tribeca last year. Is that correct?
Yeah, and it's specifically this is immersive audio, I should say, audio AR. I do think that there have been artists who have employed. I don't know, AR as a medium for expressing certain immersive experiences. So I definitely don't want to say like I'm the first because I'm not, but I do think from an immersive audio experience standpoint, like also, you know, there are plenty of people before me that were doing it with speakers in a room. So again, can't take credit for that. I will say that it was, it's built on a platform called Traverse, which is something that I developed using the Bose AR SDK that allows you to move through audio using your phone and a pair of headphones. So we worked with Yo-Yo Ma, like you do. He's very nerdy and was, he and I were talking about doing some different things. And so we took one of his suites of Bach. It's a cello suite number 2 in D minor. He was re-releasing his Bach suites. And what we did is we mapped Bach to a building in New York, the Tribeca building. So as you move through the building, you moved through the movements of Bach. So that's it. So we kind of thought about the physicality of the space, and we brought in AR art from Su Gwin Chung, who's awesome. And so it was like a full, like, you can look at the AR art and just listen. Yo-Yo Ma was spatially placed in with you, so it felt like you were moving towards him or away from him just through audio. And it was a pretty experimental, but kind of all encompassing musical experience.
So. Musical, immersive musical amalgamation.
Yes, will. Yes.
I'd love to show everybody the clip that we have loaded up to check it out, so that it's, you know, this is a visual medium after all. So I'll invite Ed Lance to fire that one up, and I'll have a look.
At the end, when you go down the stairs, I actually have Yo-Yo Ma performing and like cursing at himself, like just kind of like grumbling. So you kind of hear like kind of the behind the scenes. You never hear that. It's always him being awesome. And then it was just him going like, am I done yet? Can we stop?
It's a pity that didn't make the cut. Maybe you'll save it for your next.
Yeah, I'm sure he's probably thankful I didn't add that, but yeah.
Right. Yeah, but really, really interesting to see, you know, the overlay, the augmentation, as a tool to engage people, get them to work in a unified fashion, and really, once again, bringing us back to these tenets of, you know, original storytelling, emotional engagement, the impactful side of what the content can really, really do here in XR. But now you've taken a formal position. You're the director of the Institute for Creative Technologies at USC.
Yeah, not the whole institute, but I'm the
Director of Mixed Reality.
Mixed Reality Lab, yeah. Yes. So it's a lab that was originally started by Mark Bolas, and then Todd Richman had it for a bit, and then me. So yeah, same lab. So the lab that was originally responsible for a lot of the research around low-cost head-mounted displays. So yeah.
Yep. And you, there was a 60 Minutes piece a week or two ago, right, about some of the work that you guys.
Yeah, so that's done. That's a group, David Traum, who's awesome. He runs a natural language team lab at ICT and the Shoah Foundation, and their work with Holocaust survivors. It's the New Directions in Testimony. Paul Debevec also worked on it too. I think he's here. So
right. Mm-hmm. How much is storytelling innovation a part of the day to day there at ICT?
Oh, it's huge. Personally? It's huge. I mean, the whole, you know, the reason that there are a number of reasons I took the gig, but I think that what really is an interesting challenge from a research perspective is thinking about all the stuff that I thought about theoretically is just trying to be a storyteller in the space and how that translates and parses out to very specific research points. Meeting other researchers who have spent their entire lives working in looking at similar problems, but from a completely different angle. So I think there's a really interesting connection there between, you know, we're at a point now where we're kind of, you know, laying down the tracks as we build, or riding the train as we build the tracks, and whatever the hell that goes. Yeah. So I feel like, you know, figuring out like what do we need, like what are some sort of interesting tidbits here that we could like kind of expose from like a human behavior standpoint, from a human computer interaction standpoint. Are there pieces of technology we can be developing? It's sort of like the little, the sparks of like, how do we approach this? and then being able to like go to the industry now and say, because a lot of this hardware stuff's being, you know, it's commoditized. Everyone's building hardware. So it's like figuring out, you know, how do we engage with that? How do we expand upon that? How do we get to the nitty gritty, the roots of like what's going on here? So I think that was very attractive as a thing for me to do next.
Sure. It's exciting. Yeah. I mean, yeah. It's exciting to be on the bleeding edge and working with other people who have the mindset to, you know, actually push the boundaries of the medium at large, but in storytelling specifically.
Yeah. I mean, they don't necessarily know it's storytelling, and I don't, so I think, you know, again, it's all like words, you know, I think it's just people are interested in figuring out what's like, from a human behavioral standpoint, like what's actually happening here. Like what is this communication that we're trying to do? Like what's kind of interesting here that we can explore? And like there's this really great, it's Dr. Laurent Itti over at Viterbi at USC, and he's been training models on attention and engagement. So he's able to he's able to know if something is going to attract the kind of attention that you think it's going to attract just by using like a model that he's trained. So he and I have a research project that we're going to do together, hopefully, that will involve like looking at my theoretical, I think this is, you know, someone's going to look at that and engage that this way. He's going to have a model that either proves me wrong or says I'm right. And then I can decide if I agree or not. And then as people are starting to make decisions in a virtual environment, that he can get it, we can change certain parameters and the model can change these parameters in real time so that, you know, if you're not looking at the thing that we're hoping that you look at, we can make it a little bit more enticing to look at that thing. And so it's like kind of thinking about VR as more of an alive, you know, system-driven experience versus just a pre-baked thing that people experience and then that's it. It's like thinking of it more as an organic thing.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's taking me a moment to process that and let it sink in.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm like, you're like leapfrogging over things that don't even viably exist yet. So it's like, what do you call that?
I don't know.
Teleporting. It's hyperspacing. Hyperspacing.
Hyperspacing. Sure. Yeah. Words. Yeah. I don't.
There is no nomenclature yet. You know.
Yeah.
No, I'm trying to. I'm trying to fashion it as we speak. I'll take suggestions from the gallery here. But definitely excited to see what you guys are going to be pushing out, especially in the storytelling realm.
Yeah, thanks. We're excited.
A person who is an authority on storytelling just happens to be here with us at the moment, and when you're talking about, you know, pushing the boundaries in storytelling, AKA if it doesn't exist, we can invent it. Who better than Brett Leonard? So Brett, being someone who people look to as an innovator, I'm curious, has the landscape yet caught up with the things you've been saying for years, or is that, as Jessica's intimating, is that still in the near future?
I think it's caught up, gone beyond, and all you know, variations of the above, because it's so nascent right now. I mean, the thing that's so beautiful to me about Jessica's work is that it does really speak to this idea of creating new ritual, human ritual, and whether you call that narrative or story or whatever, it those words I think are you know, not adequate enough to really describe the thing that's starting to be played with there. And it's when I see that kind of experimentation, it really excites me. And at the same time, one of the things I'm exploring is, you know, because as being a cinematic storyteller for, you know, about 30 years now, just how can you show a story, experience a story, experience the things that are foundational in that character, you know, dialogue, these things that a lot of which have not been fully embraced by VR, quote unquote, story. And how do you do that and sort of not throw the baby out with the bathwater and yet embrace this idea of creating a world? So how do you bring the messiness of that, you know, old style storytelling into the newness of this new immersive world? And so in thinking about the project Hollywood Rooftop that we did with Seek and with Threopolis, and Mark, you were, you know, core producer on that. And, you know, it really was, the idea was to think about what would a filmmaker like John Cassavetes do if he just was suddenly given a 360 camera, you know, what, and because he was at the beginning of, you know, handheld cameras. And so he just went out and he didn't care about the technical requirements. He didn't care about, you know, things like focus and good sound or any of those things, and yet made films that really changed the nature of the independent filmmaking landscape. And so by playing with, you know, that we use the Google Jump camera, by the way, and without that program, there's no way we could have done what we did, which was shoot an entire feature film, you know, a 120-page script of character-driven, dialogue-driven, ensemble-driven story in a 360 environment, and at the same time, film it with traditional 2D cinematic tools. So it was a crazy thing to try to begin with. We did actually put both of those matching elements in the can. And, you know, what we're playing with in an extended post-production process is how to bring those things together in a way that allows engagement, the feeling of immersion in a world, and feeling like you're part of that story in terms of presence and agency, and yet also just be able to follow a dialogue-driven ensemble indie movie. So it's kind of a, you know, there are contradictions in that inherent, but that was where we started learning the most. You know, actually, I wanted to give a plug to the book, The Global Impact and Roles of Immersive Media, that Jackie Morey and Kate McCallum edited. We did a chapter in that about the process, but that was the exploration for me, is how to combine these things from, you know, the evolution of cinema and yet embrace true immersion in the context of a story world. And, you know, it's very much an experiment, but just having to force ourselves to shoot an entire feature film worth of material in both mediums, that alone was a tremendously engaging and illuminating process, that's for sure. Just the way that the performers had to adjust themselves from the 360 performance environment and the traditional cinematic environment. All of these things were just amazing process experiments for me. And you can only do that by jumping off the deep end. I mean, as Jessica was saying, building, you know, it's sort of like building the wings as you fall, you know, it's, and, you know, all the pieces are there, but you're definitely falling while you're doing it. And you have to get it in the can. So we had all the, you know, had all of the pressures of independent filmmaking, very low budget independent filmmaking. I wanted to embrace this without worrying about some of the things that all VR projects have had to worry about in terms of the technical thing. And actually the Google Jump program, because it did tremendous auto stitching from the camera, it allowed us to shoot this amount of material and actually have it to work with. So that was a tremendous boon in the process. So those kinds of technical enablements inform the process so strongly that you have to, you know, you have to pivot with those technical enablements to see what you can do. And for me, it's this idea of, you know, an immersive new wave. I've always been so attracted to the French New Wave and how those filmmakers experimented with the medium when Eclair came out with these handheld cameras. And it was an incredible rich time in cinematic evolution and expression and experimentation. And I think that is still the time now for us to play with this immersive idea of story and narrative. And so this is just one little tiny pinprick in trying to create that. That's what that project was all about, and kind of forcing all these sort of contradictory things together and seeing what happened. And we've been able to show a couple pieces of this. We went to the 5 Rs Festival that our friend Kieran Malachi Sanchez puts together. You know, it was great. It was great to show it to a number of people, and everyone were basically like, wow, we're really engaged. I'm following the story and I know who the characters are. I thought that was a tremendous victory, just that. So, but it's a, you know, it's a true multimedia project. I mean, some of the ways we're using screens in the immersive environment are reminiscent of, you know, experimentation with split screens and matrix screens in the 70s by filmmakers like Brian De Palma and the like. And so it's got all these different, you know, antecedents to it. And that was what was fun about it, is to play with all that and yet force ourselves to actually make an entire feature film, which has its own, you know, sort of organic pushing that happens in the process. So that was what Hollywood Rooftop was about.
Yeah, well, you know, as someone who lived through that and yeah. and shared the perception as we were going along, to me what was most meaningful is that we were taking the tools that existed now,
yeah.
and utilizing them to, you know, grow an evolution in the medium, which I think it's a mantra, quite honestly, because a lot of people and Ilya, you and I have talked about this. Obviously, a lot of people wait, and they have this speculative notion about where things are going to land one day and how cool it's going to be to use these tools one day. And if you sit around and wait until everything's, you know, troubleshot and go, that's on the heels of everybody else who's invented and innovated to get you there. So every year brings its own evolution of that and the new hardware and platforms and additional software that's being created are gonna embellish that at any given time. But in the style of Cassavetes and the trailblazers of independent filmmaking, I think we really did a service in just picking up the camera, getting the gang together and making something really cool.
In a projection environment, a dome projection environment that was interactive to the scene. We had the cyclorama of projection. So the whole set was a 360 immersive environment that we were living in while we were making the piece. So it was very, very self-reflexive on every level. And as the person that had to be under that dome and inside that set more than anybody, it was a crazy mentally shocking experience. Just that part of it.
So some may question if you've truly recovered yet.
Probably not.
No, probably never. Probably never. We wear these things like battle scars. But we have a 2D trailer that's an assembly of, you know, the tone, the kind of final product look and feel of it. But it's I know it's hard to encapsulate something that's a 360 3D. Multimedium experience. Yeah,
we do have a 12-minute. You know, I made one of the things about which says that I made it in what I call frags or fragments. I don't like episodes because it's not a TV series. It actually is a feature film, but it's in fragments. So the frags are, you know, 10 to 12 minutes long. That we finished a 12-minute one. That's the one we took to the 5 Hours Festival and got great response on. And we're working to finish the rest of it. We also want to do interactive things because, again, we have matching elements in, you know, a traditional cinematic sense, two camera shoot of everything there in a 120 page script and full 360 of the entire thing as well. So there's things we can do interactively. I always wanted to do this thing called the emotion lens where you could dive deeper into the 360 environment and then get some of that character's backstory or greater emotional depth in some traditional movie elements that would be able to be expressed and experienced there and then go back into the immersion. So there are things like that we want to play with these elements that now that we work so hard to get them in the can. So it's a unique set of choices, that's for sure. And we're still working. Yeah.
Well, to my mind, that might be the greatest advent is having filmed a 2D feature in the traditional sense with all the coverage that you need to get close-ups and the emotional engagement that the traditional cinema affords in the 360 environment that leaves you completely immersed and then blending them together. I think that's going to be the shockwave that kind of sets the tone for, you know, what this represents as a contribution to the zeitgeist, if you will. However, right now it's in post, as you pointed out. We've got a little sizzle trailer that we put together to show in affairs like this and
it's too bad people, we can't show the 360 piece but that's next for these kinds of panels, these kind of remote virtual panels.
Yeah,
I mean, 5G it would be a lot easier.
It's true. It's true. 5G company presents Hollywood Rooftop. Yeah. Putting that out there. So we do have a trailer, though, that we can show people together.
I'm just going to show the first 2 minutes, though, right? Just up to the end of that first,
yeah.
first section okay. With talking yes. about how it was made. Yeah, great.
Yeah, so there you have it. It is interesting. I'm slightly able. I don't know if you can hear me yet. Can you hear me yet? Can you guys hear me at the same time?
I can. Is everyone else here?
I'm able here to play an example of some of the test footage that we put together. This is one of the neat advents of Zoom itself, is that you can share a screen and ergo share a 360 video. But I just want to scrub through really quickly, Brett, some of these techniques that you're talking about. Because I think it's safe to say that we, as a collective, and I want to send a shout out to our cinematographer, Edward Button, our camera op, Russell Margo, for getting these assets in the can. I definitely want to acknowledge the editor, Steve Yoon, who by and large came up with some of these emotional lens techniques that we're talking about and managed to take this. And obviously it looks a little wonky because it's playing on a desktop and not in a 360 headset, but able to take some of these assets and blend them together in a way that to my mind has previously not in VR.
It's funny. It's in watching it and thinking about it. You notice we're using frames, and we're bringing the frames then into an immersive environment and allowing. So it's sort of like me as a filmmaker, sort of holding on to the frame for dear life to a certain degree, and yet letting it go. This project very much was an expression of that for me, because so much of my life has been, existing within the frame and within telling stories within a frame. So utilizing frames and yet keeping it within, the mise-en-scène of an immersive environment, that's the experiment. And some of these things are very early, tests of that. But, when you start to bring it together with an entire feature film story, it's really, one person said here, kind of like a multimedia comic book panels, it does have a feeling of graphic novel / cinema / immersion, all kind of connected together. And the key thing, of course, as we all know, is as people who tell stories or want to express experiences and stories, it all has to come off the emotion of the human experience that's happening within it. So it's that was the bellwether that we always had to follow, and how can we use these things as a way that not just distraction or gimmicks, but actually express the nature of the narrative and the nature of the characters. And in this context, it was very much a character ensemble. One of the aspects that was unique is that all of the actors were very new to the filmmaking process, so they didn't have any of the habits of making traditional feature film, which was very, very helpful in the context of us doing this, because when, you know, we practiced the entire thing almost like a play for the 360 camera. And the first half of the day was that. And the second half of the day was bringing in the 2D cameras and doing traditional cinematic coverage. And it's when we brought in the 2D cameras that everyone actually had the biggest cognitive dissonance. It was like they kept going, but that's happening over there. Don't you see it? They were thinking about everything in 360 all the time because they had been trained in that right from the very beginning of our rehearsal period. So again, as a process experiment, it was tremendously illuminating. And
you see here that the dome environment projected the ceiling, which allowed for ethereal entitlements narrative fashion the entire time. All this background here is projection mapped. It's it really was a smorgasbord of media available to us, and to have done it on a shoestring budget, you know, that's
was insane. Without doing things, you know, and making them, you know, possible in the context. I mean, that's why indie film is so vibrant and, you know, and pushes the boundaries of cinema, is because you're not doing it in a corporate context. You're not doing it for millions and millions and millions of dollars. And that allowed us to be able to play. Without that, again, that sort of, spirit of an immersive new wave, I don't think we're going to be all thinking out of the box enough. And so this is, again, just one tiny experiment of doing that, but, you know, doing it in the context of a lot of material, 50 hours of immersive material and 100 hours of traditional cinematic. So crazy.
And really just scratching the surface there, because as you said, it's still in post. So that was a test reel, but I find it pleasing to be able to show a crowd, you know, kind of some of the stuff that you're working on, because the whole theme of this panel is next gen storytelling, and I think it's safe to say that that's next gen.
Yeah,
right there. And of course the other portion of this panel is that it's next gen storytelling in a virtually connected world. So so I'm curious to all the panelists, if you guys see an eventual convergence of things like what we've showed here today that give you some insight into how the immersive track is moving and what's possible there, engagement factor raising, quality of the imagery becoming better and better. But do you see an eventual convergence of XR with the traditional cinema and television storytelling?
I think each medium requires its own unique type of storytelling. For example, one of the beautiful things about VR is how interactivity is natural, in ways natural to us. We interact with things in VR the same way we interact with things in the real world. And that's a very big strength to it, while TV doesn't have a strength like that. TV has a strength of you being a passive observer and you just sitting down and immersing yourself into the flat screen and time passing by, you being passive. So I think there is place for everything. There is going to be places where things touch together when one medium transcends and bleeds into another. But ultimately, it's like there is theater today and there are movies. Those are two completely different things. And theatrical performance filmed on a movie camera does not become a movie. So it's kind of the same phenomenon. While the language matures and VR finds XR, VR, AR, they find their unique face and unique place in content ecosystem.
Yes, I agree. I think, you know, this is becoming something that where there's a horizon factor to it. We can't know exactly what this is becoming. And when you look at something like all the projects that we're just shown with these three panelists today, they're so different and coming at it from different perspectives, and Jessica's work is coming at it from this, you know, fully experiential, agency driven, geographically driven. I mean, it's so many different aspects to the palette that have opened up now that that's what's exciting, to be at the beginning of a medium really defining itself, or probably multiple mediums in all honesty, if we're going to be honest about it. It's not really just one thing. And that's the thing that I think is so exciting about playing in this arena right now. Mark, you still there?
Yeah, I was gonna give Jessica a
Oh, no, yeah. I mean, it's, they said it already. Like, I think it's, I think I may have said it already too, but I think it's, you know, I think that the technology is what it is. It'll always change. I think that it helps to inspire new ways of thinking about this stuff. I do agree with Brett that I, that there are different, it's more like, it's hard to say if there'll be different mediums, but it's almost like they're definitely, it's like kind of like the way genres work with film, right? Yeah. You got documentaries, you got fiction.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, like it's sort of like, I feel like that's kind of what this is. There'll be subgenres within that too, but you know, AR by nature is different than VR. You know, but that isn't to say that, you know, those two technologies, those two formats can't speak to one another, right? We talk about, like, I think a while ago, but I was in Google Earth and I wanted to know where someone had grown up. Not, I wasn't like creeping on anybody. It was like probably Yo-Yo Ma. I was just like, where is he from? And then I was asking out loud to my Google Home. So clearly I'm being tracked all the time because I have all this stuff like connected all the time. But I asked my Google Home, like, you know, as I'm in this headset, you know, where was Yo-Yo Ma born? And you know, it was like Paris, France. So I'm like, all right. And so I went to Paris, France and Google Earth. So like, there's this kind of like need for there to be sort of a mediary between, you know, both the virtual space and the real one, and like, how do we create systems that understand what where we're in one versus when we're in another? Is it a holistic environment? Is it a holistic ecosystem where all these technologies talk to each other? So like, there's all these questions, right? We're kind of looking at, but we're kind of peeking into these little bits and bops of immersive stuff, but I believe it's all meant to kind of come together as one sort of very seamless ecosystem. And I do believe that, obviously we're already starting to see it, but you know, with machine learning and artificial systems, intelligence systems, as they come in, as we start bringing in more data, as we start relying more on real time, as we start doing more edge computing, like everything's gonna be far more responsive. And so there's also that. And I think the biggest questions that I find, the ones that I find more kind of they create very irritating content for me, is when we try to port reality into the virtual one. And I think the question remains, what are we trying to imagine? And it's still very much about, not so much even story, although that is how we encode our lives, right? And how we are able to communicate concepts, more complicated concepts to one another and to connect. But it's like, what do we make of this new space? Like, what are we doing with
it? It's a very philosophical question, and I'm so glad you brought it up. Over the last 10, 15 years, we created this whole digital world online with Facebooks, with Wikipedia, with all the digital assets, with all 3D assets created. And what, in a nutshell, AR and VR does is changing the way we interact with that digital world. Mm-hmm. And what's most interesting is probably it's even bigger differentiation by genre, because when I look at VR headset, I don't see a movie screen or a gaming device. I see a new type of computing, a new type of interacting with digital. So it's creating this whole new realm of how we connect, how we are entertained, and impacting many aspects of our lives. It's a matter of technology making it more useful, and that whole innovative day balance they talked about, like, is intense.
Well, it's all sitting on the basis of spatial computing, which is what's, you know, sort of the foundational mega trend that's happening right now. And there's, you know, new algorithmic foundations being put in place by a number of different companies and institutions that are to create operation, you know, operability in spatial computing writ large as an overall metaphor, as Jessica said, an ecosystem. You know, it does become an entire, I think, world ecosystem where all these things have been fragmented and siloed in our current media landscape, become integrated within one world experience. And that's, you know, kind of brings us to the, you know, the question of this moment, which I'll leave it to you to open that up, Mark. But it's, you know, we're in a very unique moment now in how it relates to virtual experience and telling the larger context and story of virtual experience. Phil Lilyfeld wrote a question a while back on that. Do you have that in front of you, Mark, that question about the fact that we're in this moment of cultural shock?
Well, yes, I see there's actually a bottleneck of some questions from the Q&A, which is a parlay. If there's anything specific, any questions specifically that you guys have responded to in perusing these, I'll invite you to answer them. Mm-hmm. But I think I agree across the board with everything you guys said. The one thing I will leave as a button, and at the risk of sounding like a panelist, not a moderator, I think there's a future where everything actually becomes unified based on technology, meaning whatever you're creating, the source technology behind it is probably a universal baseline technology that puts it in the can, and then post-production, it becomes whatever you're trying to make with it, and you can make multiple things from the same piece of media. That's a philosophy that I know you espouse, Brett, and I completely agree. And I think that now with the resolution of these cameras is raising to a point where you can literally capture 12K VR. It seems logical based on the kinds of things that we were showing here today that can become the master asset from which all other assets are derived, and that creates not only innovation but probably a whole new economy in terms of how immersive creators are sort of seminal keystones to making cool shit. To coin another phrase. But before we go to Q&A, I just want to ask, because I've had this WebXR bot window open. I actually don't know if people are getting to see it as we go along here. I mean, I know that a lot of people joined in WebXR, and there's still some people hanging out in WebXR watching me as I speak. Do you think this WebXR thing can solve the issue of the fractured landscape and the inaccessibility of any piece of content? Because even the stuff that we're all talking about that we showed here today, it lives on different platforms, different ways of accessing it. Whereas with WebXR, presumably you simply get a link, click a link, go in the environment, and you can watch all of it.
It solves one aspect of it. Yeah, I mean, I think it solves the thing that's been, such a friction point for virtual experience, is that you have to like have special gear and download special things and soup up your computer, all these different things that have kept it, from gaining mass accessibility. And WebXR, from my mind, and since I saw it, many years ago, was always the thing that held the promise of ubiquity, of true mass accessible virtual experience without a headset. You're still in a room that's being three-dimensionally expressed, and you can do it on a flat screen and on your cell phone, and you're there talking with people in a actual social virtual experience, and doing that with just a link that, even though it's very rudimentary right now and has been for all, but there are groups, the kind of group, the XR chat group that put up the room tonight are working very hard to create very, great extensibility on that platform. And I think it holds a lot of a hope for, a larger mass accessible experience of people connecting in a virtual space. Everything else, there's all kinds of issues to talk about in that. That's a whole other panel, really. But it's exciting to me as an entry point for ubiquity.
Do the other panelists have an opinion on that? Whether XR is going to save humanity?
It's a very interesting vision of future for saving of humanity. It brings a lot of unique aspects, which is nice. It's just finding the right use case is, I think, the key. Because I remember there was an episode of Friends where Jon Favreau character, he had this video chat. And I thought, oh my God, I can't wait for the future where we can do the same thing. And then FaceTime arrives, and I barely use it. I use it every now and then for special cases, but still talking with audio is primary source of communication, or even chatting, things are becoming shorter now. So it's a different way. WebXR is a different way. And as long as it's finding its niche, it's gonna be great. Ubiquitous is important. Just pushing the link and getting access is huge. It's making it simple, it's making it fun. Yeah. So it's a matter of two directions, and we'll see where it comes.
Yeah, it's an interesting moment, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
It has a very interesting promise for the future.
Yeah, I love WebVR, so WebXR, I think it's great.
I'm having fun in there. You know, you walk up to somebody, you hear them, it's like hanging out in a cocktail party, and I'm just doing it on my flat screen with a link. That right there is just, for me, a major inflection point in the whole concept of VR, virtual experience, social experience. You know, it's just that's kind of astonishing for me. And
no, but that points something out, because I was in alt space weeks ago.
Yeah.
Feels like actually probably a month ago, I don't know. I was in there for like an hour. And I remember feeling so drained. And I do that with most like sort of VR. I think Alex, like the Half-Life thing was the first time. Even then I felt like my head was just on backwards, which is never like the greatest feeling in the world. It was like kind of the more comfortable part. But I remember afterwards we're like, great, let's go get a drink.
Yeah.
Like someone brought out like a virtual beer, which I think is a terrible joke. And so we're all just like tossing this like virtual beer around. And I just was like, until we can come up with like, you know, like, and I think that's a big question kind of on kind of the COVID point here. Mm-hmm. Where like one of the questions we had, I actually brought up to the Institute in sort of a cheeky way was, you know, what are some social things that we would never want? Like if we had a choice between like, I'm going to have a drink with my friends, or I'm going to have a drink with my friends in VR as it stands right now, like what would I rather do? And it's like, go have a drink with my friends. Like I want to drink something. I don't want to like virtually drink something. We're not there yet where it's, so it's like, what would you rather do in VR than in real life? And a lot of the pointers go towards meetings. It's like, I would rather go to meetings in some other format than to do meetings in real life. Like that, because most meetings are irrelevant to most people. They don't actually get the job done. They're usually off topic, like all these things. And we did like a whole kind of brainstorm around like, what actually is a meeting? Like, what are we trying to accomplish with them? Like what, have we lost what meetings are? And then thinking about, you know, how do we fix those things in the immersive? Like how would something like a web VR experience fix something like a meeting? Like, and I think that's the thing, again, not so much trying to port one-to-one because we hate meetings, like generally. Right. So it's really thinking about how do we get to the truth of what a meeting's supposed to do and represent that in a better way using this technology that we have. And I think that kind of questioning across the board will help us understand how to best leverage these tools, especially at a time like this.
Exactly. It's what is the ritual we're going to come up with where we can actually have a greater level of human interaction on some modalities, not all, within the virtual space. I think there's a responsibility that's incumbent upon us for those of us at this moment of inflection where so many things are going to become remote. And I don't think we're ever going back to a completely old normal. It's going to be a new normal of some sort. But there are things that I think we can bring, you know, from a humanist standpoint into virtual connection and virtual interaction that is a big opportunity. And it's not easy. It's definitely challenging. But that also comes back to what is the story of this moment we're telling? What's the story of connecting virtually as humans? And there's a lot of ways that story can go. I've told a few cautionary tales about that in the past, and this is a moment where I think we have to really embrace a new way of achieving even deeper communication and more on-point communication, because that kind of efficiency in human interaction is going to be necessary for us to probably even survive.
And also to think about the scalability, the have and have nots, like we really do have to be cautious about the socioeconomic divide that this technology also brings. A thing again about web VR in the sense that, you know, I don't know if it's going to save humanity because we kind of fuck things up a little bit, excuse my language. But that said, I think it's imperative for us to also think about ways that we are leveling the playing field, and we're thinking about accessibility as well as access. We're thinking about, you know, there's a whole backlash with education right now around how, you know, Zoom is revealing certain backgrounds, backdrops of children's lives that they don't necessarily want to share, how schools create a common place where you can be from a poor family or rich family, but if you're in a public school, no one really knows the difference. Maybe clothes, but some people wear uniforms. Like there's a little bit of a separation there, but suddenly you're bringing kids back into their homes, and suddenly that becomes additional context for people to understand them, and they may not want that, or it creates power dynamics that are reinforced or didn't exist before, but now they do. So there's like all sorts of things to think about as we enter this era.
Absolutely. It, you know, I think the democratization energy at the core of WebXR and the people working on it is inherent to that, what you're talking about, and it's very much the sort of revolutionary tone of like doing something that is not a gated thing. It's like completely open platform, open source. You know, just click on a link and you're in, and it's the most democratization of this medium ever done so far. So, you know, that's why I think there's a lot of hope there.
Yeah, and I think someone mentioned open standards and, you know, open source. I think that exactly, it's like kind of coming up with what those standards are to keep the democratization of this stuff alive.
Absolutely. Sure.
Very interesting insight, to say the least. So this Zoom window has a Q&A panel. There's been some questions sort of bubbling up over the course of this webinar. I'm trying to field them in a way that is germane to the subject matter, but also a lot of them seem to be kind of statements. So they're long. There's like long blocks.
Like usual panels.
It's like everyone's knocking on the door to get their
some question. Things never change.
Things never change. Right. And
actually, it seems like we were concurrently answering some of them in what we were just talking about. People talking about the change that we're all experiencing right now. Mm-hmm. I would invite people to raise their hands in the actual panel, and maybe if somebody has a question, I can call on them, or if I can request that people reserve the question panel for questions, then it will help to streamline.
This part of the evening can be streamlined by actual questions.
I see one person who has their hand raised, and now I'm having fine time trying to find them. Oh, there you go. It's Greg. Greg Panos has a question. Greg, I'm gonna make your mic hot so that the panelists can hear you. Please behave. Are you there? Are you there, Greg?
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Hey, Greg.
Hey, guys. So a contagious disease has killed shared VR and VR LBE until God knows when. I just have to mention that, you know, for the last few years, I would go to many VR conferences, and I would not try anything in VR with other people trying VR. And when I decided not to do that, I haven't had a flu since. And I used to get flu 2 or 3 times a year, very bad, and go to a lot of conferences. But when I decided, you know, there's no way I'm going to put that on my head, I got to stay healthy. So it's pretty relevant nowadays with coronavirus that trying your VR or sharing with somebody out in a public setting, or having a VR place like what's the one at Disney?
The Void
and all those big, well-invested VR outfits now, are their businesses in the toilet. What are your thoughts about that? I mean, where do you think your auteurship is going to go if the public can get on the VR bandwagon by sharing?
Oh, we've got answers for you, Greg. thank you for that question. Let's go around the horn here.
Well, I think we've kind of addressed it in what we're talking about. I mean, this, you know, WebXR and having social experiences that are remote when people are not in the same place. Obviously, the LBE industry, as Greg pointed out, is hurting right now. And that was actually the savior of the virtual experience, you know, just a few weeks ago. And for the last, you know, couple of years, LBE was where the growth curve was in virtual experience. Now it has to become something that's easy to do for everybody, you know, without having to go to a special place that has special gear. And that's one of the aspects of this. And then, of course, it references the fact there needs to be greater adoption of some of the gear. Again, I believe it's the gear is going to evolve past boxes on heads, and the whole AR space, I think, is very, very unique in that way as well, because, you know, it's enabled on almost every smartphone on the planet. And we're going to have to basically be clever in doing what we're doing without having to get a bunch of people together in a space, at least for right now. And that's, you know, there's no way to know exactly where that's going to land. What is the new normal going to be? That's something that everyone has a different viewpoint on. And I wouldn't, you know, want to say what is going to be the reality, because I just don't know. The virtual remote connection is something that can still happen. And I've been hanging out in WebXR over the past couple of weeks and having Zoom communication with people. And it's helped to be able to be with people and have a social experience that wouldn't have been happening if I was just alone in my house. So, virtual experience is solving an issue right now. And that's I think, an overall opportunity for the medium and for what's going on, as opposed to, just the death of it. So
also sharing social experiences in real world opposed to virtual, it's something built into us as humans. It's something we've been doing for a couple of millennia now.
Yeah.
So we're quarantined, social distancing, flattening the curve, all that. But when the things come to normal, we would want to have shared social experiences, and we would want to go to cinemas and sports events and concerts and location-based virtual reality as well. And different countries have different adoption rates. So there is Void, for example, here, but in China, they have many, many, many centers of that. And there is a subculture going on there. Mm-hmm. Hygiene is a big thing, because sharing a headset, putting something to the face, and culture of hygiene in that is growing. And actually—
Oh, it's so gross. It's so gross.
I know.
It's so gross. Sorry.
But I mean, people, about 100 people putting headsets a day without, I'm not going to get in detail on that, but I think it's a call to up the standards in that department for location-based, which is a good thing. So the standards on that is going to be growing for sure. I wouldn't say location-based is dead. It's a call for evolution. It's going to innovate or it's going to die.
Yeah, it's not dead by any measure. I mean, it's just furloughed, as is face-to-face industry right now. I think the growth curve was indicative of people's fervor for it, and I think as this whole unprecedented situation that we're all currently experiencing in real time evolves or passes or cleans up or whatever the outcome may be, I think some sense of normalcy will return, and ultimately speaking, people will want higher forms of entertainment when they leave their home, largely only because that's the way they can get them at these centers that are equipped to provide the maximum experience, and they command a higher dollar. So it's never going to go away. It's tough because a lot of companies were functioning at a very high level, and the future looked really bright. And this is the one thing that you couldn't quantify may tip the scales, but it will return.
I'm going to say it's not going to return.
Yeah. I think
it's all going to have to change. Like it's like,
I love it. Descent. Systems, go on.
All systems I'm with are going to change. Justin. Yeah. All systems are going to change. Everyone's freaking out because like, you're seeing businesses go under, like the whole restaurant world is like messed up. Like they have to rethink everything. The, you know, entertainment is going to be totally different. It has to be. Like, there's not going to be a party at the end of this where we all leave and we're like, COVID's over. High five. I'm going to like bum rush a whole festival. put a bunch of headsets on. Like, this is such, this is going to be such a slow, like, fade. Like, it's going to take a long time. And plus, we're not going to be able to come out of this at all until there's a vaccine, which isn't going to happen for at least 18 months. So, you know, forget LBEs. Like, thank you, like, the Void, like, hang in there. Meow Wolf's already, like, canned a bunch of its employees. Like, a lot of, I mean, we're looking at like a reset button that has not happened in a long time. And I think the at-home market, if we're gonna talk business here in terms of innovate or die, to Ilya's point, is like the at-home market, it's where it's at. People just want some sense of normalcy, which means like I listened to a podcast the other day, like ESPN, like I've been listening to lots of podcasts, like where are podcasts gonna go? Podcasters are like, what do we make? Like, we're not in our studio anymore. Like, you have people, like a friend who works at, who's a host at Reply All, PJ, and PJ's like, I'm just trying to figure out what the next episode's gonna be. Like, do I have to release more? David Chang has a podcast, and he's like, I'm a restaurateur. Do I just spend all my time complaining about how my restaurants aren't gonna do well anymore? Like, what do I do? And MLB is like, do we have our entire Major League Baseball season in Arizona in 102 degree heat? And like, how do we televise that? How do we do it when one person gets infected? How, like, it's all different. And so our jobs really are, how do we connect people to something meaningful? Like, how do we get them to come out of their house? How do we have people in quarantine who can see their, like, just hang out with their families? Like, people want connection, and I think stories a part of that too, but there are all these new places that we really need to be focusing on. And I stress this, that we need, it's going to require new modes of thinking and new solutions, and that's where storytellers need to go. I think
I agree completely. I think that it's going to be a new protocol. I mean for almost every aspect of, you know, where humans gathered, you know, like you said, the restaurant industry is a perfect primal example. It's never going to be exactly the same. Will that mean you have to prove you're not infected when you go to places? I mean, there are things about this that are draconian, that are a bit scary to contemplate. But then that's why I think it's incumbent upon those of us working with virtual experience, remote experience, to really think, what is the meaning, as you said, just of the meaning we can bring to this that is positive, that pivots to the positive genius of the group mind, you know, because we can activate the group mind in virtual experience probably better than almost anything else because of the way in which, you know, people be connected, share elements, be actually empowered to create in a democratized way. These things are inherent to what the potentials are for this medium to address these new levels of protocol. And it's, you know, we're just 1 month in here. This is a very fresh thing, you know.
That's exactly it. It's only been like a month and a half and it feels like years. We're just like, what's going on? You know, like, everything's different now.
And, you know, contemplation, contemplation for all of us. And that, if we can address that and actually do that as a group in a positive way within virtual experience, I think there's something that, if that becomes a central tenet of it, where it's not just about hanging out and doing small talk and passing around virtual beers, I mean, that's, that novelty wears away really fast, right?
It wore away 5 minutes ago. Yeah, exactly. It was never good.
So we have to get to greater connection and meaning and utilize these tools to evolve us as opposed to de-evolve us. And that's a huge challenge for the group mind, but I think that there's, you know, necessity is the mother of invention, and this moment, this inflection point, can actually be a tremendously positive thing for human evolution if we focus that way. There's obviously a lot of other elements to it that aren't, and I'm not trying to be Pollyanna about it, but it's just, if we don't focus on the positive, I'm worried about what will happen. And those of us in this kind of remote connection thing, and what's the experience of, you know, even storytelling and all these aspects within that context. I mean, the idea that cinemas are going to come back the way they used to be, I don't know if that's ever going to happen. And that's hard for me to say as a person who's loved cinema my whole life, you know, but it's really a moment where we have to consider, what is that newness going to be that we pivot to because of this thing that the, you know, nature's way of telling us something has been wrong. And now here we are.
I agree. There is definitely no way of coming back, and not in a dramatic sense of that, but time moves only one direction. And it affects television, it affects home entertainment, but still when this is over, people would want to go out and it would go for evolution in that area. This is not the first and sadly not the last pandemic in the history of humanity. And always we thrive so far to come back at it. And a lot of the problems all across entertainment and beyond, a lot of them, they were already there. It's not like they came out of nowhere. It was talking about movie theaters, which I love with all my heart, but they did experience many issues before that. So
It was the OTT platforms have disrupted the entire model. So this has just been, you know, another step in that disruption, and mm-hmm. that's already happening, you know? So it's, you know, it is, for me, it looks organic to what was already going on. And now this natural event is something that makes us point, you know, to what is going to be the new protocol. That is, you know, for everything. And there, it won't be an old one. It can't be, we can't go back. And I think that scares people to consider that the world that existed doesn't really exist in that same way anymore. But that can also be an incredible moment of, you know, for lack of a better term, rebirth. And that I think is a moment that we must embrace, at least as a storyteller, I'm going to embrace it, because what else are you going to do?
I mean, this is also preemptively, like, we have automation, right? Like that's going to happen.
Yeah.
Like that's going to mm-hmm. happen. So like, I don't want to be like the naysayer here, but it's more like we're already on a trajectory where we do have to rethink these systems anyway. And something mm-hmm. like a pandemic really forces us to like focus some of our attention on, okay, if this happens again, what do we do? Yeah. Like, and how do we, you know, and I think it's less about this, like, I mean, there's other systems that need to be rethought of, most likely. But I think, you know, as creators, as people working in this medium, where the medium promises a lot of the solutions that could be helpful right now, I think it's more of a fire under our butts to figure out how do we provide these solutions now. 100%. So that the next time this does happen, it's not like, oh, I wish I could go to a, like, that's like baseline what VR has always promised. Like, wouldn't it be great if you could travel around the world? And now we're like, that was the point, and now you can't because no one can get a headset. Like, it's this kind of crazy thing where we're like, this is literally the reason that, you know, it's not the only reason, but it's a truth of the medium that I think we can apply to a lot of the problem sets here that we should just have next time.
Yeah. And for, I mean, from the sound of it, you guys aren't even saying that that's a finite window that we have to kind of, you know, push this all forward and figure out ways to help the world virtually connect. I mean, I see a lot of people in the comments section equating what's happening right now to the 1918 pandemic, the Spanish flu, and how shortly thereafter, you know, everything flipped and it became one of the you know, seminal moments in history where everybody, things were booming, right? The roaring 20s. I wonder if, I totally agree with everybody's point that nothing will ever be the same. And right now we certainly can't even quantify how much will change in terms of the normal life that we once knew. But I'm calling it, you know, tempered pessimism, because I think human nature is going to dictate that people will seek out the routines that they previously had, and businesses that don't port over into this new way of doing things may have been businesses that were, you know, outmoded when this began, and that's an important consideration. Whereas all of us as immersive creators and thought leaders would. The case may be, even in just in this panel, you know, we've been subject to people telling us, oh, those are what you're planning on doing, that sounds great, those are great ideas, that's going to come one day, and we were set in, sort of put in a box based on the status quo that was being set forth, and now here all those dynamics have flipped almost overnight, and suddenly I can speak for myself and almost pretty much everybody that I know that's in this space, that, you know, that there's been more interest, more enthusiasm, more activity, and that's ultimately going to speak to presumably more investment into the space for solutions and forward-looking advents, not to mention content, which there was a dearth of to begin with. So there's a great deal of upside, but it's because we were in an industry that was betting on the future, not an industry that was clinging to the past and trying to suppress what the future may look like. And those are key distinctions because the pandemic may have been a trigger for it, but the outcome may have been inevitable for a lot of sex industry, which remains to be seen, I suppose.
I mean, that's where a lot of the economic structures that, you know, I mean, suddenly things like universal basic income and these things are suddenly becoming part of the mainstream discussion, not necessarily on the extreme left wing, because we have to look at what is going to be the overarching infrastructural issues, you know, that this connects to and is affected by. And that's a new way of mode of thinking. I think bottom line is we got to think in new ways and we've got to connect in new ways and we have to communicate deeper in new ways. And if we can have this, you know, these mediums that we're talking about be embracing of that, I think that could be a very positive thing.
Well, at the very least, we can all get on a Zoom and chat about it.
Yeah, as we are.
At any point throughout this.
Privacy stuff.
You're just going to throw that out there, right?
Like, such the dystopic. I am very hopeful, but yeah, like, there's also that.
Oh, yeah.
Not their fault. They went from zero to like 150% in less than a week. So,
yeah.
I don't know if that's actually true details. I'm just saying, generally speaking, metaphorically, they were unfortunately overloaded fairly quickly. So,
that's why this has to be a revolution. It's got to be something that we bring these tenets to: democratization, sovereignty of our own data. All these things are now necessities, you know, that are, you know, brought. They're not just party banter and you know, in the sort of dialectic out there. They're becoming something that's so necessary to figure out, because everything that's happening now is connecting to that, those issues.
And it's happening in real time too, which is the exciting thing, because many amazing companies and initiatives are going to be born from this time. I think it's safe to say that that we at the immersive landscape or virtual world have a seat at the table and be heard how we can contribute to solving the problems that a lot of the world experience. To that point, you know, we're in the home stretch here of the panel, but and there's a few people that threw out some questions here at the end that I don't even know if we have time to answer them all. I might propose,
like, we just do rapid fire, like we just like look at the question and then like one of us answers real quick.
Yeah, that's good.
As long as you do peekaboo rapid fire, where you don't know what the question was right before. Okay, just like throwing a dart. Well, I was actually going to propose that we could migrate this into the WebXR environment.
I gotta eat dinner. Are you kidding me? It's like 8:01.
Yes.
In the house, and he's just like, "What the heck is going on?" I'm like, "We're talking about economic politics and XR right now. Rentals won't make themselves." I'm like, "Gosh, okay."
Yeah, that's interesting, because it is like, because we're all remote and connected now. There are people that seem to think that everyone has got like infinite time to be on the phone and connect by Zoom. That's just not the case.
That's like, I'm up at 5 a.m. I have to walk over to my computer and start my day. I'm like, yeah, no.
Yeah, but I think a few of us that want to go back into XR, WebXR, just to discuss a few things. I'll go back in there for a few minutes anyway. Mark, if you want to, and Ilya and anybody else that's listening. If you want to jump into the WebXR room, it could be a bit of a free-for-all communication in there just for fun. So why don't we do that? I think that's a great idea, Mark. I second that emotion.
Yeah, I was just going based off of the notion that this thing was supposed to last until 9. So you weren't going to eat dinner, Jessica, until 9:01.
Nine? Really? I didn't know that.
I yeah. certainly didn't know that either.
Deep dive.
I would have gotten way, if you think I got like, I can get like way dystopic with no food. Like it is. it is bad.
All right. Well, that wasn't in your bio. Maybe you should add it.
Yeah.
And for the next one.
Angry or what yeah. is it? Like,
no, it's fine because I really think that we've done a fine job here of comprehensively covering the subject matter. And there's always room to expand. And I think that's a good thing, particularly for this series of panels that we're starting or continuing. They were happening back when we all mingle and get together. But we're reconfiguring things and to my mind, you know, this was a great success and an ongoing experiment. We all learned some things. You see how many windows I have to deal with back here to moderate this thing. but by and large, I hope that the attendees felt like it was a rewarding time, and I deeply appreciate the time spent with the panel. You guys are all awesome.
It's been a pleasure, and thanks everybody that came to listen to us in little tiny boxes. And everybody keep safe and stay healthy, and I'll see you in WebXR.
Thanks, everyone.
Ooh, Ed.
You guys rock.
Thanks, Ed. Thanks, all. Everybody at SIGGRAPH who put this together and on the whole SIGGRAPH board and Ed and everybody. So thanks so much.
Rock and roll. Let's do more.
It's been fun. Absolutely. All right.
Thanks, Brett. Thanks, Ilya.
Thanks, Jessica. Thanks, Ilya.
Cheers.
Bye, you guys.
See you in WebXR. Bye-bye.
Take care for now.
And guys, you can check the link in the chat window for WebXR if you want to jump in there. I'll post it one more time here so everyone has it.
Yeah, there's two windows. One's an overflow room, but everybody should still be able to convene. So bye for now. See you.
Cheerio.
Cheerio. See you there.
Bye.